开始把这个Amazon 的老板，他的虚拟才刚刚开始这个概念呢，跟大家来先做分享。Amazon 的这位这个 Jeff Bezos， 他是一位奇人啊，意思是非常奇特的人。现在我们看到他很成功，可是因为我比较年长的关系，我看到 Amazon 刚刚开始的时候，几乎他是被每一个人看衰的一个公司，大家都觉得是说啊 idea 很好，可是不可能成功，所以他在一开始的时候是赔了非常非常多的钱。可是他哪里来那么多钱可以赔呢？他基本上没有钱可以赔，所以他是不断的让自己的进步，就是他不断让自己的公司不断的进步，不断的花钱，可是不断的进步，让很多人去投资在他的公司，所以他的公司基本上有很多的资金，可是一直在赔钱，直到赔到他整个的累积的效应达到了一个市场的爆发点，他就开始赚钱了。所以如果从这个角度来看，为什么我说他是奇人？第一个就是他能够让别人相信他，第二个他就是他非常用功的让自己能够真的做出成绩来，第三个他非常有自信，虽然大家都说他不会成功，在华尔街有很多人说他不可能的，但是他还是一路走过他这个认为该走的路。就像是出电子书也是一样，大家也觉得电子书怎么有可能呢？可是他现在一路一路走，一路一路走，那么已经走到一个相当成功的一个地方。那么我每一次把我的电子书拿给朋友看的时候，大家都相当的惊奇，觉得说为什么看起来像真的书一样。因为它跟我们的荧幕最大的不同，它就是它没有背光，因为没有背光，所以它没有吃多少电啊，所以没有吃多少电，那也读起来眼睛很舒服。1999年，也就是10年前，当时的《时代》杂志，你也不得不佩服《时代》杂志在当年选它作为年度的风云人物，封面的风云人物。那么现在10年过去，他当然比当年更稳健的让大家知道说，这个公司是已经是一个非常成功而且非常有未来的一个公司了。我们来看看他跟我们说的是什么样子的一个题目。
When you think about resilience and technology, it's actually much easier. You're going to see some other speakers today, I already know, who are going to talk about breaking bones stuff. And of course, with technology, it never is. So it's very easy, comparatively speaking, to be resilient. But I think it's also, if we look at what happened in the internet, it was such an incredible last, you know, half a dozen years that it's hard to even get the right analogy for it. And a lot of how we decide how we're supposed to react to things and what we're supposed to expect about the future depends on what kind of, how we bucket things and how we categorize them. And so I think the tempting analogy for the boom bust that we just went through with the internet is a gold rush. You know, it's easy to think of this analogy very different from some of the other things you might pick. For one thing, both were very real. They took, in 1849, in that gold rush, they took over $700 million worth of gold out of California. It was very real. The internet was also very real. This is a real way for humans to communicate with each other. It's a big deal. Huge boom, huge boom. Huge bust, huge bust. You keep going. In both things, there were lots of hype. I don't have to remind you of all the hype that was involved in the internet, the getrich.com. But you had the same thing with the gold rush. Gold, gold, gold. 68 rich men on the steamer Portland. Stacks of yellow metal. Some have 5,000. Many have more. A few bring out $100,000 each. And people would get very excited about this when they read these articles. The El Dorado of the United States of America. The discovery of inexhaustible gold mines in California. And the parallels to the gold rush and the internet rush continue very strongly. So many people left what they were doing. What would happen is, and this went, in the gold rush, it went on for years. People on the East Coast in 1849, when they kind of first start to get the news, they think, this isn't real. But they keep hearing about people getting rich. And then in 1850, they still hear that and they think it's not real. By about 1852, they're thinking, am I the stupidest person on earth by not rushing to California? And they start to decide they are. These were community affairs, by the way. Local communities on the East Coast would get together, and whole teams of 10, 20 people would caravan across the United States, and they would form companies. These were typically not solitary efforts. But no matter what, if you were a lawyer or a banker, people dropped what they were doing, no matter what skill set they had, to go pan for gold. This guy on the left, Dr. Richard Beverly Cole, he lived in Philadelphia, and he took the Panama route. They would take a ship down to Panama, cross the isthmus, and then take another ship north. This guy, Dr. Toland, went by covered wagon to California. This has its parallels too. Doctors leaving their practices. These were both very successful, physician in one case, surgeon in the other. Same thing happened on the internet. You get drcoop.com. In the gold rush, people literally jumped ship. The San Francisco harbor was clogged with 600 ships at the peak because the ships would get there and the crews would abandon to go search for gold. So there were literally 600 captains and 600 ships. They turned the ships into hotels because they couldn't sail them anywhere. You had dot-com fever and you had gold fever. And you saw some of the excesses that the dot-com fever created, and the same thing happened. The fort in San Francisco at the time had about 1,300 soldiers. Half of them deserted to go look for gold. And they wouldn't let the other half out to go look for the first half because they were afraid they wouldn't come back. And one of the soldiers wrote home, and this is the sentence that he put: the struggle between right and $6 a month and wrong and $75 a day is a rather severe one. They had bad burn rate in the gold rush. Very bad burn rate. This is actually from the Klondike gold rush. This is the White Pass Trail. They loaded up their mules and their horses, and they didn't plan right, and they didn't know how far they would really have to go, and they overloaded the horses with hundreds and hundreds of pounds of stuff. And in fact, it was so bad that most of the horses died before they could get where they were going, and it got renamed the Dead Horse Trail. And the Canadian Minister of the Interior wrote this at the time: thousands of pack horses lie dead along the way, sometimes in bunches under the cliffs with pack saddles and packs where they've fallen from the rock above, sometimes in tangled masses filling the mud holes and furnishing the only footing for our poor pack animals on the march. Often, I regret to say, exhausted but still alive, a fact we are unaware of until after the miserable wretches turn beneath the hooves of our cavalcade. The eyeless sockets of the pack animals everywhere account for the myriads of ravens along the road, the inhumanity which this trail has been witness to, the heartbreak and suffering which so many have undergone cannot be imagined. They certainly cannot be described. And you know, without the kind of the smell that would have accompanied that, we had the same thing on the internet: very bad burn rate calculations. I'll just play one of these, and you will remember it. This is a commercial that was played on the Super Bowl in the year 2000.
You said you had a large selection of invitations.
But we do.
Then why does she have my invitation?
What may be a little thing to some?
You are mine, little man.
Could be a really big deal to you.
Is that your wife?
Not for another 15 minutes.
After all, it's your special day. OurBeginning.com. Life's an event. Announce it to the world.
It's very difficult to figure out what that ad is for. But they spent $3.5 million in the 2000 Super Bowl to air that ad, even though at the time they only had $1 million in annual revenue. Now here's where our analogy with the gold rush starts to diverge, and I think rather severely. And that is, in a gold rush, when it's over, it's over. Here's this guy. There are many men in Dawson at the present time who feel keenly disappointed. They've come thousands of miles on a perilous trip, risked life, health, and property, spent months of the most arduous labor a man can perform, and at length, with expectations raised to the highest pitch, have reached the coveted goal only to discover the fact that there is nothing here for them. And that was, of course, the very common story. Because when you take out that last piece of gold, and they did incredibly quickly. I mean, if you look at the 1849 gold rush, the entire American River region, within 2 years, every stone had been turned. And only after that, only big companies who used more sophisticated mining technology started to take gold out of there. So there's, I think, a much better analogy that allows you to be incredibly optimistic. And that analogy is the electric industry. And there are a lot of similarities between the internet and the electric industry. With the electric industry, you actually have to, one of them is that they're both sort of thin horizontal enabling layers that go across lots.
那个大概不应该翻译成电子产业，它应该讲的是电力的产业。就是 electrical industry 事实上是在讲电的产业，不是我们现在所了解的电子产业，所以这翻的不是很好。
Some different industries, they're not, you know, it's not a specific thing. But electricity is also very, very broad, so you have to sort of narrow it down. You know, it can be used as an incredible means of transmitting power. It's an incredible means of coordinating in a very fine-grained way information flows. There's a bunch of things that are interesting about electricity. And the part of the electric revolution that I want to focus on is sort of the golden age of appliances. The killer app that got the world ready for appliances was the light bulb. So the light bulb is what wired the world. And they weren't thinking about appliances when they wired the world. They were really thinking about, they weren't putting electricity into the home. They were putting lighting into the home. And, but it got the electricity everywhere. It took a long time. This was a huge, as you would expect, a huge capital build out. All the streets had to be torn up. This is work going on down in lower Manhattan. Where they built some of the first electric power generating stations. And they're tearing up all the streets. The Edison Electric Company, which became Edison General Electric, which became General Electric, paid for all of this digging up of the streets. It was incredibly expensive. But that is not the, and that's not the part that's really most similar to the web. Because remember, the web got to stand on top of all this heavy infrastructure that had been put in place because of the long distance phone network. So all of the cabling and all the heavy infrastructure, I'm going back now to sort of the explosive part of the web in 1994 when it was growing 2300% a year. How could it grow 2300% a year in 1994 when people weren't really investing in the web? Well, it was because that heavy infrastructure had already been laid down. So the light bulb laid down the heavy infrastructure, and then home appliances started coming into being. And this was huge. The first one was the electric fan. This is the 1890 electric fan. And the appliances, the golden age of appliances really lasts, you can sort of, it depends on how you want to measure it, but it's anywhere from 40 to 60 years. It goes on a long time. Starts about 1890. And the electric fan was a big success. The electric iron, also very big. By the way, this is the beginning of the asbestos lawsuit. There's asbestos under that handle there. This is the first vacuum cleaner, the 1905 Skinner vacuum from the Hoover Company. This one weighed 92 pounds and took two people to operate and cost a quarter of a car. So it wasn't a big seller. This was truly, truly an early adopter product, the 1905 Skinner vacuum. But 3 years later, by 1908, it weighed 40 pounds. Now, not all these things were highly successful. This is the electric tie press, which never really did catch on. People, I guess, decided that they would not wrinkle their ties. These never really caught on either. The electric shoe warmer and dryer, never a big seller. This came in like six different colors. I don't know why. But I thought, you know, sometimes it's just not the right time for an invention. And maybe it's time to give this one another shot. So I thought we could build a Super Bowl ad for this, but we'd need the right partner. And I thought that would really work. to give that another shot. Now, the toaster was huge because they used to make toast on open fires, and it took a lot of time and attention. Now, I want to point out one thing. You guys know what this is. I hadn't invented the electric socket yet. So this was, remember, they didn't wire the houses for electricity. They wired them for lighting. So your appliances would plug in. Each room typically had a light bulb socket at the top, and you'd plug it in there. In fact, if you've seen the Carousel of Progress at Disney World, you've seen this. Here are the cables coming up into this light fixture. All the appliances plug in there.
意思是说那个时候房子没有插座，因为它是先有电灯，所以我们现在看起来很好笑，就是它的这个电风扇插在哪里，人插在电灯泡上面转上去，所以它的插座插头就是这个电灯泡的头，就是转在电灯泡上面，那边有电，所以电扇就会跑。它在举这些例子，就是要告诉我们大家，我们现在看到的这些什么电子书啊什么等等，不管你看起来它是有多进步，其实你把它想象成那个时代，就是那个时候的人觉得这样子也很进步，可是我们现在觉得看起来实在是很落伍。
You would just unscrew your light bulb if you wanted to plug in an appliance. The next thing that really was a big, big deal was the washing machine. Now, this was an object of much envy and lust. Everybody wanted one of these electric washing machines. On the left-hand side, this was the soapy water, and there's a rotor there that this motor is spinning, and it would clean your clothes. This is the clean rinse water. So you'd take the clothes out of here, put them in here, and then you'd run the clothes through this electric wringer. And this was a big deal. You'd keep this on your porch. It was a little bit messy and kind of a pain, and you'd run a long cord into the house where you could screw it into your light socket. And that's actually kind of an important point in my presentation, because they hadn't invented the off switch. That was to come much later, the off switch on appliances, because it didn't make any sense. I mean, you didn't want this thing clogging up a light socket. So, you know, when you were done with it, you unscrewed it. That's what you did. You didn't turn it off. And as I said before, they hadn't invented the electric outlet either. So the washing machine was a particularly dangerous device. And there are, when you research this, there are gruesome descriptions of people getting their hair and clothes caught in these devices. And they couldn't yank the cord out because it was screwed into a light socket inside the house. And there was no off switch, so it wasn't very good. And you might think that that was incredibly stupid of our ancestors to be plugging things into a light socket like this. But you know, before I get too far into condemning our ancestors, I thought I'd show you, this is my conference room. This is a total kludge if you ask me. First of all, this got installed upside down, this light socket, and so the cord keeps falling out, so I taped it in. This is supposed, don't even get me started, but that's not the worst one. This is what it looks like under my desk. I took this picture just 2 days ago. So we really haven't progressed that much since 1908. It's a total mess. And you know, we think it's getting better, but have you tried to install 802.11 yourself? I challenge you to try. It's very hard. I know PhDs in computer science, this process has brought them to tears, absolute tears. And that's assuming you already have DSL in your house. Try to get DSL installed in your house. The engineers who do it every day can't do it. They have to, typically they come 3 times. And one friend of mine was telling me a story. Not only did they get there and have to wait, but then the engineers, when they finally did get there for the 3rd time, they had to call somebody, and they were really happy that that the guy had a speakerphone, because then they had to wait on hold for an hour to talk to somebody to give them an access code after they got there. So we're pretty kludgy ourselves. By the way, DSL is a kludge. I mean, this is twisted pair copper that was never designed for the purpose it's being put to, and it's, you know, it's the whole thing. We're very, very primitive. And that's kind of the point, because you know, resilience, if you think of it in terms of the gold rush, then you'd be pretty depressed right now, because the last nugget of gold would be gone. But the good thing is, with innovation, there isn't last nugget. Every new thing creates 2 new questions and 2 new opportunities. And if you believe that, then You believe that where we are, this is what I think, I believe that where we are with the incredible kludge, and I haven't even talked about user interfaces on the web, but there's so much kludge, so much terrible stuff. We are at the 1908 Hurley washing machine stage with the internet. That's where we are. We don't get our hair caught in it, but that's the level of primitiveness of where we are. We're 1908. And if you believe that, then stuff like this doesn't bother you. This is 1996. All the negatives add up to making the online experience not worth the trouble. 1998, Amazon.toast. And 1999, Amazon.bomb. My mom hates this picture. But you know, if you really do believe that it's the very, very beginning, if you believe it's the 1908 Hurley washing machine, then you're incredibly optimistic. And I do think that that's where we are. And I do think there's more innovation ahead of us than there is behind us. And in 1917, Sears, I want to get this exactly right, this was the advertisement that they ran in 1917. It says, "Use your electricity for more than light." And I think that's where we are. We're very, very early. Thank you very much.
Good. This part, the most important is to let us know that a already so successful company's manager, he is talking about his company now issuing Amazon.com.不管是多么赚钱，或是他们现在在出电子书，他觉得我们跟1908年的那一台洗衣机没什么两样。那一台洗衣机是三个筒子结合起来的，那三个筒子上面还没有插座，还没有可以开的，还没有可以关掉的这个开关等等。今天跟我们的讲的话说 ，We are 1908， 就是我们是在1908年，因为我们在1908年，所以我们就有许许多多的空间可以去进步。那这个是今天透过这两个影片来，一方面让大家了解虚拟的世界跟实体的世界有很多直接的关联，那是刚刚第一个 MIT 的学生的很多的这个作品让我们了解的。第二个是这个成功的人告诉我们，他内心里深深的相信我们现在是在1908年，我们正在使用的，就像是我现在在桌子上用的这台电脑，看起来在多年以后，就是说1908到2008这100年之后，它看起来应该就是这个一台怪怪的洗衣机这样子的一个距离。所以如果我们把今天的两个影片结合起来，我们大概会相信我们还可以进步的空间有很大。接下来跟各位谈一谈，就是我们今天学到什么。我们今天的第一段是跟各位分享大家在做功课的时候的一些成绩，以及功课做得不错的同学的一些成果，还有我们大家经常这个错误的部分。第二个部分呢，是跟大家谈到刚刚的那两支影片，也就是虚拟世界跟实体世界的这个结合的可能性。但是我们不要忘记，我今天跟各位特别介绍到两本这个书，一本是杂志，一本是书。一个呢是何威鹏先生的概念，工作多一点。那另外呢，一个是这个艺术这一本书。我特别再把艺术这本书的几个段落跟大家分享 ，in case 各位没有真正的去读这一本书。这本书在一开始的时候有一个非常有趣的段落，那这个非常有趣的段落我来跟各位说一下。他在一开始的时候就说到，这个在美国打这个职业棒球的这个棒球选手，他们有许多生日集中在一月份，所以如果你听到这样的一个报告，你看到一个职业球队，那你看到这些职业球队的球员里面，居然有超过一半的人都是一月份生日，你会想什么？
我第一个想到是我也是1月份生日。
然后嘞？
然后。
所以你也可以去打棒球。
我不知道。想到看到，可是看到这份资料， 我只是觉得它可能是一个数字上的、生日上的统计而已。对，那如果是一个科学家，可能会研究说，为什么一月份的人会运动神经特别好，或什么？因为一月的天气是怎么样，或在怎么样的情况下出生，然后怎么样怎么样，所以他的基因上可能什么什么运动神经特别好什么，可能科学家会想到吧。可是对我来说的话，我只想到说，我也是一月份出生的。
好，一月份生日，你如果看到那么多人打职业棒球都是在一月份生日，你会想什么？
因为我基本上我看过这本书，所以就我知道，
所以你知道结果。好，
所以我会想到我也是一月份生日，然后只是想说，就是一月出生的人会有什么共同点？但他们就是会，就是特别适合去做某些事情。
好，来看过这本书的人跟大家分享，他说什么？
其实他这个意思就是说，就是他这个统计数据是根据说这个年次出生的，从一月到十二月，为什么一月的球员表现得特别突出？是因为说他在整个学习过程是比较完整的。
为什么比较完整？
因为。就像我们，他的意思好像是说，就是，不好意思，有点晃。他的意思说他意思就是说，这个学习的阶段是比较完整的，所以他得到的那个资，例如说，我们入学入，例如说，一般我们入学的那个年次是在九月，在每年的九月，但是如果有些人可能就是九月以后的人。要入学的话，那他们统计说，这些九月份以后提前入学这些学生，他们在成绩上的表现是比正常一到九月入学的学生还要差，是这样子，我记得是这样子。
好，大概是差不多意思，不过逻辑没有讲对了哈。他的意思是这样哈，就是。美国的职业选手都是一月份出生的多，原因是因为美国的少棒，他们在分说你是哪一年进来打球是，他是从一月一号到十二月三十一号这一年的当成一个 group， 所以这一年的一月一号生出来的人跟这一年十二月三十一号生出来的人，他差了十二个月，可是同时进去打球，知道吗？他们进到。某一年的一月一号到十二月一号，他都把它当成说这一年，所以他到了小学去打少棒的时候，虽然你都叫六岁，可是一个是六岁头，一个是六岁尾。那六岁头的人是不是长得比较大？长得比较大的人是不是常常被派去打球？其他长得比较小的，是不是常常去坐板凳？所以他的概念就是说，这些常常被送上战场去打球的人。当他到了中学的时候，因为他打得多嘛，所以他也打得比较好，所以又再被送上战场，所以他不断的被派到战场上去，所以他到最后当然比较容易变成职业球员，因为他是从小就有好的训练，那所以这个是一个概念。那从这个概念呢，我们就可以来看一下所谓的成功的意思。其实从这里大家已经可以知道我要讲的意思是成功的意思是什么。我们来看一下，这个莫扎特的例子。他说，这个世界上是不是真的有与生俱来的才能？全世界的心理学家已经针对这个问题激辩了几十年，答案显然是的，并非所有的曲棍球员只要是在一月出生都能变成职业选手，只有那些天生好手才办得到。成就是才能加上准备的结果。问题是，心理学家仔细研究天才型的人的生涯，发现成功最主要的关键似乎是准备而非才能。90年代初期，认知心理学家 Erickson 等人曾在柏林一流的音乐学院进行一项研究，他们在该校的教授协助下，把所有主修小提琴的学生分为三组。第一组是明日之星，也就是将来有希望成为扬名国际的小提琴家。第二组只是资质还不错，至于第三组则难以成为职业音乐家。研究人员 问每一位修习小提琴的学生同样一个问题，你从小什么时候，从学小提琴的第一天到目前为止总共的练习的几个小时。第三组的学生，也就是他们觉得不太可能会有成就的这三组学生，我念另外一段，这三组学生开始学琴的年龄都差不多，全部是在5岁左右。头几年每一个人练习的时数大概都是一个星期两三个小时，到了8岁真正的距离开始出现了，能在班上名列前茅的人练习的时间要比其他的学琴孩子来得长。9岁的时候每一周练习6小时，到了12岁每周练习8小时，到了14岁的时候每周练习16小时，到了20岁如果还在努力练习，以职业音乐家为导向，那每一周练习的时数则超过30个小时。在20岁的时候，这些明日之星每一个人总计已经练习了10000小时。相形之下，还不错的那一组，也就是第二组，练琴的时数大概是8000小时。至于那些未来只能够当普通的这个音乐的这个人才的，练琴的时间大概不会超过4000个小时。Erickson 等人接下来比较职业钢琴家跟职业的这个业余钢琴家之间的结果，发现同样的区分，业余的在小时候一星期练习时间从未超过3小时，到了20岁练琴的时数不超过2000个小时。至于职业钢琴家，练习的时数逐年增加，到了20岁，也就像那些小提琴的明日之星，练琴的时数总共也是超过10000个小时。所以他从这个例子以及其他的许许多多的例子去解释所谓的10000小时的奥秘是什么。所以今天跟各位在分享功课的时候，我特别谈到10000小时的这个概念，也就是跟各位同学解释，如果你希望你现在学的事情到未来是非常成功的，你千万要记得10000小时的这个概念。因为天分虽然是有用，可是那个10000小时的准备才是真正的功夫。他没有那个10000小时的准备，再有天分都没有用啊。所以这个是重要的一个概念。另外还有一点想要跟大家分享，这是在书的最后，他谈到这个有一个学校专门收这个资质不好、社经地位比较低的家庭的小孩来教育他们。他说1990年代有一个学校叫做知识力学校诞生了，这所公立学校推行的是实验教育，它设在这个纽约那某一个大楼的4楼。那么他们专门收的呢，就是说一般这个收入比较低的家庭的学生。那我就不一块一点一点念，我主要是要告诉大家说，他们这个实验的小学呢，这个实验的这个学校呢是非常特别，它是这样子。知识力学校属于中学，学生从5年级到12年级都有，一般有很多学生，5年级的学生分为2班，每班各35人。这所学校没有入学考试，也没有入学资格的申请，一律抽签入学。以 Bronx 区为例，所有4年级的学生都可以去抽签。入学的学生半数是非洲裔，半数是西班牙裔，3/4来自单亲家庭，90%的学生家庭清寒，可以获得免费午餐，或者是午餐免供应的是这个减免。从学生家庭的背景来看，这样的学校似乎跟其他贫民区的学校没有什么两样。可能有很多让人头痛的问题学生，然而你走进这个知识力学校，立刻可以感觉这所学校非常大的不同。学生在走廊上井然有序，安安静静的列队前进，在教室如果要说话，则必须遵守学校的规定交谈的原则，微笑站起来发问，仔细倾听并点头，以及看着别人。学校走廊摆好几百面大学的校旗，那些校旗都是校友毕业以后申请就读的学校。去年 Bronx 区参加知识力学校抽签的有好几百个学生，只有48个学生可以抽中。知识力学校创校以来不过10来年的历史，已成为纽约市大家最想挤进去的公立学校。为什么是这样子？ 知识力学校的强项就是数学教育，在这些学生当中有16%的学生可以拿到，在 Bronx 区全部的中学只有16%可以及格，但是在知识力学校五年级结束的时候，许多学生都说数学是他们最喜欢的科目。为什么是这样子？所以他到最后，我跳过去念结论，他们事实上发现暑假是错的，因为他们做了一个实验，把暑假那三个月都去玩的学生跟暑假那三个月都在继续念书的学生做一个比较，他们从 念书开始的三年的中学的时间，他发现从进来的时候资质差不多的学生到毕业的时候，暑假放得比较短的学生变成成绩非常的好。所以他认为在19世纪发明的一个说学校要放暑假的这个过程，是为了那个时候的社会的现象，因为要回家去帮忙做家事。结果现在到了21世纪，大家还暑假变成没事做，所以没事做的这件事情让所有的学习中断。那因为这个中断，所以他认为这个教育有问题。所以这一段是我觉得是需要同学们去深深的思考。当你在暑假的时候，你也可以把它拿去玩掉，你也可以把它拿去增加你的知识力。所以这个部分呢，是一个当21世纪是一个知识竞争的时代，你的知识力你不必去掏金，你不必去走很远去挖金矿，你的金矿是在你自己的脑袋里面。我跟各位教过，你的脑袋就是一大堆脑神经细胞，那些脑神经细胞等着你去花，不是懂得，等着你去花时间让它连接起来。当你看一本书的时候，它就连接了一部分；当你听一场演讲的时候，它就连接了一部分；当你思考一个你想不透的问题的时候，它连接了更多的部分。所以你越弄你不懂的东西，你就越进步的越快，但是所有这些进步大概都是辛苦的。所以这个是这一本艺术这一本书呢想要告诉大家的。我最后再利用这一本书的一个结论来告诉大家，这本书的这个作者，刚刚各位看到他的照片，他是牙买加人，他的这个曾祖母事实上是一个奴隶，他被从牙买加进口到美国，被他的曾祖父买去。他觉得他的出身帮助了他的成功，为什么？他认为他的出身虽然不好，可是因为出身不好，所以他能够经验到许多比较辛苦的工作，所以让他变成比较成功。那个比较辛苦的工作，就像是一月份生的人，因为比较容易被送上战场，所以他有一大堆练习的机会。所以这些练习的机会，练习受苦的机会跟练习学习的机会是一样的，因为受苦也是一种学习。所以今天透过大家写的作业的时候呢，希望跟大家真正的非常深度的去分享，作业虽然看起来很简单，但是你作业认真做，事实上是促成你养成未来成功的习惯啊。所以这个是我今天花很长的时间一直不停地跟各位谈作业，并不是因为要跟各位谈这个作业有交没交，而是在谈说作业这件事情，事实上就是你养成习惯的开始。